from the high desert. Take a ride from the high desert and the great American Southwest. From the Coast to Coast AM archives, you're listening to the best of Art Bell.
From the high desert and the great American Southwest, I bid you all good evening, or good morning, as the case may be across all these time zones. Howdy.
Hi, Art. How you doing?
I'm doing.
So, from New York City, staying up late, here is Dr. Malachi Martin.
For a very long time, I've been on a search for some sort of proof of life after death.
Here is somebody who calls himself Single 7. Single, are you there?
Yes, I am.
There's going to be the biggest UFO sighting of the century.
You're listening to Art Bell on Premier Networks.
In the great American Southwest. I'm Art Bell, and this is the program that goes coast to coast to coast to coast and all the way around the world, more or less. Good evening, everybody. Should be an interesting night, actually. We're going to have Gordon Michael Scallion here in hour two. Gordon is going to talk about possession. Now, that's something, you know, out of left field from Gordon to me. I still have no idea why he wants to talk about possession. And the answer is obviously because he knows something, right? Gordon Michael Scallion has a very rich, interesting history as somebody I regard as absolutely the real McCoy, so possession should be an interesting subject indeed from Gordon. I'll tell you about tomorrow night's show in a moment, or at least part of it. It seems that we've caught an Al-Qaeda biggie. He is Abdurrahim al-Nashiri, and I'm sure I slaughtered that. Oh, well. He's Al-Qaeda's chief of operations for the Persian Gulf and a suspected mastermind of the USS Cole bombing in October of 2009. And we've got him in custody. My guess is that we're asking really hard, prejudiced sort of questions of him right now. Officials offering all this up sort of unofficially. In other words, they don't get named. NATO leaders pledged Thursday to help the United Nations, quote, fully and immediately, end quote, disarm Iraq. They also redrew the political map of Europe, reaching behind the former Iron Curtain for seven new members. Joining Latvia, Estonia, and Lithuania are now Bulgaria, Romania, Slovakia, Slovenia as the next wave of NATO states. I wonder what they think about that in Moscow as they see their old territories go into NATO coloring on the map. Must be hard to watch for them. Angry mob stabbed and set fire to bystanders. Why would they do that? Thursday, in rioting that erupted after a newspaper suggested Islam's founding prophet would have approved of the Miss World Beauty pageant. It's not a laughing matter, so many died here, but why? Because they approved of the Miss World Beauty pageant, or suggested that the founding prophet would have approved. At least 50 people were actually killed and 200 injured. Now, that we fight over the damnedest things in the world, don't we? Angry mobs stabbed and actually set fire to bystanders. We now find out as many as 50 died because somebody suggests that their prophet might have approved of the Miss World beauty pageant. A waves of black sludge from a major oil spill washed ashore amid high winds and driving rain Thursday, tarring new stretches of northwest Spain's scenic coastline. This is a big one coming in now. This one was mixed up, churned, and is now being delivered by 60-mile-an-hour winds off the coast there. They say it could be the biggest spill ever in the world's history. In a moment, I will tell you about tomorrow night's show. But tomorrow night's going to have to do, of course, with Roswell, you know. By the way, I know this is probably going to sound silly, but I've been getting a lot of, a whole lot of emails from people who are observing, would be the right word, observing invisible airplanes. And I know this sounds whacked, but they're observing, not by seeing necessarily. Well, that's partially wrong. I've had some people who have emailed me, and they said when these planes are flying across and below a cloud formation, they see a kind of a shimmering something, and that's seen against the cloud. Seen against blue sky, nothing. Some people have heard these craft. Other people say you can neither see clearly nor hear these craft at all. But I'm getting a lot of email reports, so I would think that, and they're coming very diversely, you know, they're very diverse observations. So I think we have an invisible aircraft. And I don't mean just radar invisible, I mean invisible aircraft out there that's being tested right now. Anybody else have any observations or perhaps revelations that they would like to share with me? I remain Art Bell at mindspring.com. That's Art Bell, A-R-T-B-E-L-L, at mindspring.com. So if you know something and wish to share it, be my guest. If you've made an actual observation, by all means, be my guest and write to me, Art Bell at mindspring.com. Obviously, we've got something up there that you can't see or you can't really see. Now, tomorrow night, listen carefully, in an effort, in trying to unravel a mystery that may involve the War of the Worlds, cable TV sci-fi channels turned to a group of educated men and women with shovels and has set them loose on the southern New Mexico desert. I'm reading you a Reuters story here. In an effort to verify once and for all whether a UFO crash landed in New Mexico more than 50 years ago, the cable TV channel sent a team of archaeologists to conduct an in-depth study of the legendary crash site. And just like the alleged government conspiracy by those who say aliens landed near Roswell, New Mexico, the results of the scientific study are top secret. That is until November 22nd, tomorrow, when Sci-Fi airs the Roswell crash, startling new evidence, which will include what network representatives are calling a smoking gun, in quotes. Until then, believers and debunkers will just have to wait, said Bill Dolman, principal investigator with the University of New Mexico archaeological team. Dolman, along with three other archaeologists and six volunteers, were hired by the Sci-Fi Channel to conduct the research, which took place over 10 days last September. We found things, some things I still don't know what they are, but they surprised me, said Dolman, reiterating his confidentiality agreement with Sci-Fi. Sci-Fi representatives say the program promises never before eyewitness interviews, late-breaking revelations, and a, quote, smoking gun bombshell, end quote, which does not necessarily coincide with the archaeological findings. The smoking gun is fascinating and compelling. It's going to raise a lot of questions afterward, according to Thomas Vitale, is it Vitale or Vitale, a senior vice president of the programming at Sci-Fi. The supposed crash of an alien ship in Roswell on July 3rd, 1947 has become legendary. Of course, according to some accounts, the ship crashed in an empty field with several aliens on board. Witnesses claim to have seen extraterrestrial beings, which were taken away by military personnel, never to be seen again. Those who believe an alien craft landed are adamant the incident involves a huge government cover-up. The government, of course, in turn says the incident involved a weather balloon, and the accounts of aliens comes from anti-military conspirators. Now, who should we get on tomorrow night? Well, Bill Dolman. Dr. Dolman is going to be here, that's who. He headed the archaeological team that went in and did this work and came up with whatever. We're going to find out tomorrow night. Check listings. I think here on the West Coast it's like 5 o'clock here. But check your TV guide. It might be 5 or 6 o'clock, whatever, on the Sci-Fi Channel. Should be pretty interesting. An archaeological dig at Roswell. We'll see. All right, here's something else I would like to explore with you because something is going on our nation's highways. Something really strange. This really is strange. There's some truck drivers out there who are being followed from state to state, receiving threats of death over CB radio. As a matter of fact, truckers are reporting cars following them, even so far as into Canada. On the Bill Handel show a few days ago, there was another truck driver, a younger one, apparently called in, mentioned this very same thing as happening to him as well, even mentioned the several cars that swarmed around his truck and simply will not leave him alone, all with the killing talk over the CB radio going on the entire time. So something is happening to truckers out there, and I wonder how prevalent this is, whether any other truckers out there have heard about this happening, or has it happened to you? Is this some new horrid little twist of American subculture? You know, or what's going on out there? I would like to know. And I know that I've got a lot of truckers listening. So are you hearing these stories? I mean, are you guys hearing these stories on the road? Because I know how that grapevine works. Here's an interesting email from Mark. Hey, Art, watching the U.S. Farm and Dairy Report Saturday morning, soybean fungus is now with us. Soybean fungus. I immediately thought, he says, of Ed Dames about the fungus coming. Listen to this. They call it soybean rust because it looks brownish in color. It is worldwide, predicted up to a 50% crop reduction. And, of course, you know, there will be chemicals used to combat the fungus. They have pamphlets out now telling us how to identify this. That sounds like a bad fungus, and this sounds like a bit of a problem to me, what I'm about to read you. There is something spreading among the students in Pasadena's Independent School District. Since the beginning of the school year, there have been about 50 cases of what's called MRSA, a staph infection that is resistant to certain antibiotics and can be tough to treat. The bacterial infection actually discovered about 2 weeks ago, or 2 weeks into the school year, rather. Officials think the infection may have started with some of the team sports, perhaps football. Pam Exner has two children who have contracted a bacterial staph infection known as MRSA. Says they got it at this high school where they both attended class. She asserts everybody at the school got it, all the football players, all the dance team. Pam says her son, who's on the football team, has had to make 20 trips to the doctor thus far, has missed about 13 days of school because of the boils that are attacking his skin. Symptoms first appeared 2 months ago. She's not particularly happy with the way the school district is responding thus far. Here's another one. A 40-year-old Detroit woman had endured painfully infected foot sores for more than a year. Doctors gave her numerous antibiotics. Nothing worked. Finally, last April, they amputated one of her toes and made a fairly frightening discovery. her sores were infected with a new strain of the bacterium Staphylococcus aureus, it looks like, or Staph aureus, by stealing genetic material from another bug. This new strain, it seems, has become totally resistant to venomycin, the longtime drug of last defense. Health officials wouldn't identify the Metro woman or what hospital treated her. The infection was the first of its kind in the world, and a landmark defeat for doctors and public health officials in the fight against growing antibiotic resistance. It was also evidence that the Detroit area has become an incubator for resistant strains. So in other words, we're beginning to get more and more things out there, little bugs, that are getting smart to us. This is a very, very long article. I'm not going to go into the entire article, but I think that you should all be aware that I am certainly aware. I've become aware for some time now that this is what we're going to face. This is going to be perhaps our greatest, most immediate, well, maybe not most, I suppose there's Iraq, right? That's the most immediate challenge. But coming up in the world of small things, I think we're, you know, it goes back and forth. I mean, we gain a little on them, they gain a lot on us, we gain a little on them, they gain a lot on us. And at some point here, they're going to make a quantum leap that we have not made with our drugs. And for at least a period of time, they're going to begin to win, and that's going to have very profound consequences for millions. This is from the Oakville Beaver newspaper, because it's up in Oregon. This is a story about a man named James Burchill, who apparently is obviously not worried about burning in hell. He was too busy this week just having fun auctioning off his soul. Now, this man said, when the conventional fails you, go with the unconventional, said he. As a business development and marketing consultant, I look for ways to promote a product or service. In this case, I was looking for a powerful way to promote my own services at the same time demonstrate my creativity and commitment, like offering my soul to the highest bidder. So he listed his soul on eBay at about 9 p.m. Monday. Ad said, for a limited time only, I am offering my immortal soul to the highest bidder. This unique collector's edition immortal soul is priceless and can be yours just in time for Christmas. According to the blurb, Burgil's soul is just under four decades usage. Estimated airtime left is about 50 years. This, of course, refers to his lifetime usage. No warranty expressed or implied is given for any past life usage. Oh, God. Later, the ad says, I'll let you in on a secret. I have estimated my soul's value and placed a reserve on it. My immortal soul doesn't come cheap. And if I sell it too low, I devalue the whole, or is that soul market, and there will be the devil to pay. Just to be on the safe side, his reserve bid was $10 million. Figure high enough that an actual taker was very unlikely. And so that he wouldn't contravene eBay's strict policies. Because, of, you know, you see, the policy is that if they offer the amount of money that you say has to be offered, in this case, the reserve, $10 million, then you've got it, baby. Auction over. Right? So anyway, eBay did what they do, and they pulled the ad at about 12:40 a.m. on Tuesday. So it was all over, no more soul sale. In doing so, this is the part that I thought was especially interesting. The firm informed him, quote, eBay appreciates the fact that you chose to list your auction number so-and-so, one gently used immortal soul with us. Unfortunately, your auction was in violation of at least one or more of our listing policies. Therefore, we have ended this auction. All fees have been credited to your account. eBay does not allow the auctioning of human souls for the following reasons. If, this is one, if the soul, this is from eBay directly, if the soul does not exist, eBay could not allow the auctioning of the soul because there would be nothing to sell. 2. However, if the soul does exist, then, in accordance with eBay's policy on human parts and remains, we would not allow the auctioning of human souls. Then it goes on, important notice, be aware, future incidents of this nature can lead to the suspension of your account. Multiple violations for listing prohibited items can, you know, it goes on and on. This is like eBay covering both sides of the possibility, right? They're not saying it does or does not exist. They're saying either way it's against the rules. Our rules. If the soul does not exist, eBay could not allow the auctioning of the soul because there would be nothing to sell. But if you're eBay, you can't leave it right there, can you? So they cover, however, if the soul does exist, and in accordance with eBay's policy on human parts and remains, we'd not allow the auctioning of human souls. I'll tell you something. I think we probably do, and I repeat, I think we do have souls. I'm convinced we have souls. And in all the years that I've been interviewing people in ufology and those people who have had contact with the visitors, whatever they are, there has always been a reference to souls. In fact, one of my earlier interviews in doing all of this was John Lear, son of Bill Lear. You know, he's a pilot. And one of the last shows, and he did a period of a year and a half of solid shows with me, a fascinating man, who doesn't do these kind of shows anymore at all. But one of the things that he told me was that we were regarded as vessels. Human beings were regarded as vessels, nothing more than something to bear or to carry the soul. All right, we're going to do some open lines headed toward the top of the hour from the high desert. I'm Art Bell, and this is Coast to Coast AM.
I know you can see me, now here's a surprise. That you have, cause there's magic in my eyes. I can see 4 miles and miles and miles and miles and miles. If you think that I don't know about the little
Dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. Or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network.
Exactly what it is. In a moment, we launch into the unknown of the night. Stay right where you are. By the way, the guy who sold his soul asked whether his ploy may have provoked a less humorous higher power. He said, he meant no offense, that I wasn't attempting to be blasphemous, just tongue-in-cheek. It was just a promotional piece to show my flair for the creative. Well, I know how it all turns out. It always does. You die, and then, you know, Rod Serling's waiting for you, and Rod Serling informs you that you didn't know it, but God bid, you know, and he hit the however many million it was, 10 million, right on the head. Or was that God that bid? First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art.
Hi.
Hey, you want to talk about that trucker incident?
Uh-huh. Yeah, actually, I do. You're a trucker?
Yeah.
And have you heard of this occurring prior to my reading it tonight?
Yeah. I heard it. I'm a Southern California local driver. I have a CB in my truck.
Uh-huh.
And I talked to a lot of drivers that, you know, come from cross-country during the night.
Right.
And I heard one driver who was talking about he was on I-40 out in Oklahoma City. He was talking to a bunch of other drivers. We were all having a conversation. He was saying he had a car in front of him, hit his brakes, accelerate, really pissing him off. Another driver came alongside him. Obviously, they knew each other, doing the same thing, swerving at him, honking a horn,
really?
Giving him the finger. Really weird stuff. But I remember when that trucker notified the authorities during that rest stop, I knew something strange was going to start happening to drivers. It was something just, I don't know how to explain it, but something just told me something was going to start happening to truck drivers because of that incident.
Great. This country is incredible. I mean, just the underbelly of what goes on in this country is really foul. A lot of it's really foul. I mean, people who are just killing for no reason. In fact, we're going to be talking about that in the next hour. People who are just killing and doing these things that you would normally really attribute to some satanic something, right?
Correct.
I mean,
correct.
This kind of killing is so bad, it's just like satanic.
Correct. And it's sad that it was a former military man. That's really sad.
Yeah.
Very sad.
Yeah, see, that's worrisome. I mean, here we are, the first caller, and you're telling me, yeah, you've heard about this.
Well, it's bringing the military into it. It's sad to me because I was raised by a World War II Marine and a man who loved his country, loved his family, loved his job, loved everything. Happy to have survived Guam and Bougainville. And it's just sad to hear about all. It's just sad what's going on with this country.
Well, one thing for these four-wheeled whoever they are, is to keep in mind is, what is the average big rig weigh?
Fully loaded, it's 80,000, so it's 40 tons.
80,000 pounds.
Yeah, it's dangerous.
And what does the average Toyota weigh?
Little four-wheeler cars, probably about 3,500,
3,800. 3,500, 3,800 pounds versus
No, a big sedan, like a police car, would be about 4,800.
4,800 versus 80,000.
Oh, hey, let me tell you, they pull in front of you, slam the brakes on, they try and get off the off-ramps, they go right in front of you. I've had them play games with me, and I look at them, I go, what in God's name could you be thinking? I could...
Darwin Award candidates.
If I was crazy, I could kill you in a second.
Darwin Award candidates.
Yeah.
I appreciate your call, sir. Thank you. Well, that's very, very, very worrisome. I wonder if that kind of thing is going on. Now, again, the reports include other kinds of harassment that man was just talking about, threats of death over the CB radio, being followed across state lines, in fact, even across international lines, right up into Canada. That's pretty weird stuff, isn't it? Pretty weird. Wildcard line, you're on the air. Hello.
Yes, I didn't get a chance to tell you before. I made some amazing discoveries. I never heard anyone say it.
You mean what kind of a, what do you mean?
I think you'd be very interested in it.
Well, I'm listening. What?
The only thing is, I would like an opportunity to say it off the air. Is there any way I could do that?
Yes, but not so that I can hear it. So, I mean, you'd be talking to yourself. So
no,
you better do what you can right now.
You or George Norrie, is there any way to get in touch?
Yeah, I have email, artbell@mindspring.com.
Right, I'm not going to write. I need to talk.
Well, then no. So you're going to have to say it here.
Also, I'm very interested.
You haven't said anything yet. What?
Okay, I once heard George Norrie say that you had an out-of-body experience.
That's correct.
And I'm very interested in it.
Why?
Because I also did. So I'd like to hear yours.
Well, I've told mine ad nauseum, but I will repeat it for you one more time. It's the only time this has ever happened. And I don't know why it happened. I don't know what brought it on, and it's never happened since, okay? But I was in Paris. I was on vacation. My wife and I love Paris. We went to a hotel in Paris. Beautiful hotel. Paris is a very romantic city. And we went to sleep. And I was not asleep. There is no question in my mind. I was not asleep. And in one instant, a time you couldn't measure and I couldn't remember, I mean, just an instant, I was out of my body. I was up above the city of Paris. I was looking down on Paris, although that was not by any means the what I was concentrating on in that flash. I was in some other place of perfect ecstasy, would be the only way to describe it. Utter, complete ecstasy and understanding and all the rest of it. You know, everything everybody says about this kind of experience. And then, boom, I was right back in bed. And I was so surprised and shocked that I woke up my wife, which was not, is never a good idea, you know, to tell her about this. And just really was babbling away because I was so excited about what had just happened. And I attributed to being out of my ordinary environment. So that was my one big experience, but it was absolutely real. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes, Rex from New Orleans.
Hello, Rex.
WSMV.
Yes, sir.
Down here, and I also get you on WLAC out of Nashville.
Ah, yes.
But one thing about I'm an old ex Air Force type about your age. I sort of like your choice of music.
Ah, thank you.
Really simpatico sort of thing there. Listen, I'm agnostic at best about things, but my wife is a devout Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
And when I first mentioned that, I listened to you off and on and throughout the year since about 94, and I'd missed the original Rod presentations. But when I, on this latest flap, I caught your discussion, and I related it to my wife, and she said, she's a nurse, and she said, well, you know, they're everywhere, as you describe, right? In the sea, in the air, some large, some small, some inside the house, some as short as 4 inches.
They
right?
Sure as heck are. And
right,
sure
and she said, well...
That cameraman back, I think it was in Pennsylvania, who got the unmistakable corroborated video that they're studying, that's a rod.
Right.
No well, two ways it's anything but...
Oh, right, and I saw the video. Also, but here's the point. She said, well, it's perfectly clear to me. She said, those are the vessels that contain our spirits when we die.
Huh.
They're having fun. She's often wondered, for example, as a nurse about babies whose spirits are not totally formed.
Yes.
Okay, and they die early.
Yes.
She said, and, you know, they're having fun. They're everywhere. They're in the ocean. They're playful, as the description goes. Interested? That's where we go, and those are the things. She says that they move effortlessly through the air. She says it's all described in the Bible of the spirits are everywhere. And she said that was her take on it.
Well, maybe that's right. I mean, these rods, whatever they are, and, you know, even Jose would be the first one to tell you, he doesn't necessarily know what they are. He doesn't know what they are, and I'm not sure what they are either. They could as easily be human souls as anything else. They obviously operate at some slightly different or even largely different frequency.
Right.
We're beginning to get more and more of a glimpse of them in various ways. It may have to do with a lot of things we're doing right now on Earth, technologically, I don't know. But anyway, we're starting to see them more and more. And but maybe that's what they are.
And that was, as a Catholic, that was her take on it.
Hey, believe me, it's as good a take as any. I thank you very much.
Surely.
Take care. Yeah, it's as good a take as any. They could be creatures that have nothing to do with human beings, one way or the other, before or after. Or they could even be souls. Maybe that's what we're seeing. Who knows? They're not missiles. The FBI thought they got a photograph of one. They thought it was a missile. At first. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Greetings from the Uinta Mountains in northeastern Utah.
Yes, sir.
We're hearing you on a CC radio up here, and it sounds great.
Well, that's as it should be and would be on a CC radio, yes.
And I have to tell you, greetings from my dog, who for about the past 6 months listens to your show, and I think understands it probably better than I do.
Well, I'll have to think about that statement, but thank you, I think.
A comment about the increase in bacterial infections that are resistant to antibiotics and every treatment we've thrown at them.
Isn't that scary stuff?
It sure is. I work at a medical laboratory, and I've recently done a study of other studies, and in about the last 48 months or 4 years, we've seen an across-the-board between 20% and 30% increase in resistance.
Yeah.
All bacteria strains, all antibiotics. Uh-huh. It's really scary.
Yes.
And I think something that may be going on that would explain a number of these phenomena, that we're experiencing what you've called a quickening, mm-hmm. absolutely no doubt about it. Mm-hmm. And I think what's happening is that the universe is trying to tell us we got to wake up. We got to use the abilities, spiritual, psychological, psychic, whatever, that have remained latent in the human race for so long. We've got to use them. We've got to wake up and start using them. And if it's a crisis that mandates that we use them, that may be what gets us to finally wake up, or we'll become extinct.
It's an absolute possibility. Our becoming extinct, that is.
Oh, yeah.
We're so used, you know, the American people are so used to science saving their butts that they can't even grasp the concept that science is losing this one right now. They're actually losing this one, and that just doesn't register because we don't lose like that. We always win.
You're absolutely right that these things make quantum leaps every time we just barely start to catch up with them. They make quantum leaps ahead of us. You know, we're just getting a grip on cancers and leukemia, heart disease, and I think we may very well come, as Ed Dane says, close to being wiped out by these things if we don't get a handle on them.
Well, I mean, how else do you look at a bug that can't be killed? I mean, that bottom line, that's what we're talking about. A bug that can't be killed has been born.
Yeah, and it's an enemy, and it'll destroy us if we don't find a way around it. I've got a suggestion for your guest tonight.
Yes.
That he might comment on either a spiritual dimension of the UFO and alien phenomenon, or an extraplanetary dimension of spiritual phenomenon like possessions.
I am burning with curiosity, actually, to find out exactly what Gordon has to say
on
the subject. I mean, this has just not been down his alley. This came out of nowhere, and I haven't talked to Gordon, so I have no idea what's coming. We'll see.
Yeah, I'm interested, too. Have a good night, Austin. Good evening.
Thank you very much. Good evening. First-time caller line. You are on the air.
Hey, this is Bob, Art, from Alamogordo, New Mexico.
Yo, Bob.
And we've been seeing in the western sky the last two nights these vapor trails. There's been five of them in the same spots two nights in a row. Have you heard anything or anybody call on anything like
yes,
that?
Yes, Bob, I have. I have several emails about what you're talking about.
Well, what do you think we're looking at down here?
I don't know. Honest, Bob, I don't know. All I can do is confirm that I have several emails that I'm holding about the subject.
Two nights in a row,
yep.
Same time, same spot.
Yep.
Tonight we were driving down the mountain from up on Rio Doso, and bigger than life. They're not moving like an aircraft was doing them, and real strange.
We're coming into a very interesting time when we're getting an awful lot of sightings of an awful lot of strange things, Bob. It's happening all at once. Interesting to know. Thank you. I don't know what to say to that except to say to all of you, we are getting into an extremely interesting time. Maybe we're about to enter one of those great flaps, you know, when just gazillions of things are seen suddenly. Wildcard Line, you are on the air. Hello.
Hey, good morning, Art. Greetings from Denver.
Yes, sir. Greetings.
I am calling about our southern border. Have you heard about what's going on down there lately?
With reference to...
Smuggling illegal aliens, things like that.
The usual.
Well, it's actually something new. There's a congressman from Denver, Tom Tancredo, who's out front on the immigration issues. I was watching last night on O'Reilly. He just came back from the border, And he said the Border Patrol agents have reported to him they're catching a lot of what they refer to as OTMs, other than Mexicans. And a lot of them are Middle Eastern men that the Mexican crime syndicates are now smuggling in for $50,000 a pop.
Wonderful. Just exactly the kind of news we need. Well, I know
it'd be great.
It's almost an insurmountable problem. It's almost insurmountable. I mean, that's one gigantic, long border.
What do you think about putting the military on the border?
Mexicans
do it to their southern border. They have the same problem on their southern border that we do.
All right, I'll tell you this. I think that if another major incident occurs, if we were to know for sure, for example, that somebody had managed to get an atomic bomb into the country or something of that magnitude, and you can't rule that junk out, right? If there were another attack, if something catastrophic occurred, then I think that you might see exactly that occur. You might actually see the borders get locked up. It would be an awful thing to see happen. But you might see it. You really might see it. You might see them lock this country up tighter than a drum. It could happen. Many things would happen before a nation would allow itself to become extinct for lack of doing nothing, for doing nothing. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi, yes.
Hi, extinguish your radio first. That's the number one thing. There you are.
It's WVOC. Radio in Columbia, South Carolina.
That's the way to do it. Yes, dear.
I was calling about spirits.
Yes.
I had an out-of-body experience. I was violently attacked and cut up and burned and left for dead. And it's...
You mean while you were out of body?
I was tied up with...
Whoa, slow up.
Okay.
While you were out of body or in your body?
I was tied up with cable ties, rope, and duct tape.
In real life,
I was kidnapped, raped, and tortured in 1994.
Oh, my God.
I had this lunatic that told me he had murdered two women, that I was going to be number three.
Sounded like you were.
He said he was a Satan worshiper. I went through more hell than anybody can comprehend. I was strangled. Tried to suffocate me. I passed out through a lot. I only came to when he would scream, "Are you alive?" While he was tying me up to four corners of the bed with cable ties, rope, and duct tape, he started pouring straight vodka in an IV bag. He ran through my left nostrils, down my throat, and to my stomach. I couldn't run. I couldn't scream because he had duct taped my mouth up. And I just started praying. I didn't know what else to do. And my prayer was, "God, give me the strength to get through this."
Well, apparently he did, because here you are. We don't have a lot of time.
Yeah.
We're coming toward the top of the hour, but I mean...
And God's wisdom to me was control the fear and the panic, and I will walk you through this.
What was
brain, use it.
This man's motivation?
He said his father had sexually molested him all of his life, and his mother was dominating, and he hates all women. All women to him are prostitutes, sluts. I mean, he went on and on, and I can't remember most of it. The cops figured out it was 20 hours I was tortured. It was big time.
This man is now in jail.
He's free. According to law, we had consensual sex. I have no memory of the trial. He only spent 9 months behind bars. But during the attack, I had an out-of-body experience, and I loved it on the other side. I went into total darkness just for a second.
All right, listen, we're out of time. I appreciate that. I think you're sharing that with us. That's pretty horrible. That sounds like a soul possessed. That's what we're going to talk about coming up in a moment. From the high desert, this is Coast to Coast AM.
Touched the moon, but he left me much too soon. His lady girl. He left his lady bird. Lady bird, come on down. I'm here waiting on the ground. Lady bird, I'll treat you good.
Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
It is indeed. Good morning. Gordon Michael Scallion is a futurist, a teacher of consciousness studies and metaphysics, and the author of the best-selling books, Note, Notes from the Cosmos, A Futurist's Insights into the World of Dreams, Prophecy, and Intuition. Educated in electronics, he is indeed. Gordon Michael Scallion experienced a health crisis in 1979 that led him on a path of self-discovery and the ability to access higher states of consciousness and view both the past and our probable future. His latest work, The Future Map of North America, third edition, contains his visions of what America will look like geographically by 2012 as a result of Earth changes. Gordon Michael Scallion's ability to forecast Earth changes, the future of our planet, and economic trends have been featured on NBC, CNBC, Fox Television, Unsolved Mysteries, Discovery Channel, Learning Channel, hundreds of other radio and television and print media around the world. His updates, his insights, and strategies for living successfully in the 21st century in his monthly newsletter, Intuitive Flash, where he made the following predictions. Hurricane Andrew, the Landers Big Bear California earthquakes, the Kobe earthquake, terrorist attacks in America. Remember his talking about the terrorist attacks, folks? The decline of the Catholic Church due to hidden secrets, and war in 2002 in the Middle East over Palestine. In a moment, Gordon Michael Scallion. However, tonight, the subject, the main topic, is going to be very different. We're going to talk about possession. All right, it's been a while. A very good friend, I've said, I always say, and I always will, this man is the real McCoy. His name is Gordon Michael Scallion. From the East Coast, northeast part of the country, New Hampshire, I do believe it's Gordon. Are you there?
I am.
Excellent. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
I'm burning up with curiosity about the subject we're going to be speaking about tonight, Gordon. But just before we do get to it, if you wouldn't mind, Gordon, if there are any Earth changes, updates, anything that we should know since we last heard from you, I certainly would like to have those.
Sure. We're in a warming up period right now.
Awesome.
It's been building for the past about 14 months. This past solar cycle really got it kick-started. But what I see occurring right now has more to do with the trigger for Earth changes that are coming. I've stated on your show and in my book and other places that the change is really coming from a shift in the internal part of the Earth, or the core of the Earth is actually moves at a slightly different rotation than the external part, or the crust of the lithosphere.
Right.
And the core occasionally takes little jumps or jerks, very slight. And these, I believe, transfer to cause the Earth to kind of wobble. There's a term for it known as the Chandler wobble, but there's other terms and there's other cycles for the same kind of wobble. But I believe in 98, the Earth core got a good jolt. And now we're starting to see the manifestations. It's kind of like a washing machine when it starts to spin out of balance and shake.
Yeah.
And that's what's been building. So what we're going to see here in the next, perhaps 6 months, is we're going to start to see more quakes. The recent Alaska quake was a good-sized jolt.
7.9.
Yeah. The warning signs that I gave on your show years ago was that we needed to watch for simultaneous volcanic eruptions that would occur, especially ones that have been dormant, for some time. And now we're seeing a lot of volcanic activity in many places in the world, both in the arid and also the frigid areas. And so these are caused by this instability in the Earth, and it's driving more and more magma to the surface. So, you know, everyone wants to know when is the next quake and where is it going to be. And that, you know, is why I created the map to kind of show what the patterns would be. But areas to really watch for now is Peru is one area that I'm getting a lot of little flares are going up saying watch South America in particular. Also, the northwest part of the United States mm-hmm. is an area that I see under great stress. So that would be Northern California and Washington, Oregon, that region.
I've been hearing about bulges in mountains in the northwest.
There has been upthrust. In fact, you know, fortunately, we have great technology through satellite measurements, and so we can see when ranges change or the elevations change. And good-sized quakes, of course, will cause the Earth to change its contours. And so there has been, and we do have the data to suggest that land masses have risen, but it's not uncommon after good-sized quakes that we see this. The bulges, however, if they're accompanied by increased thermal activity in the ground, that's a real warning sign that we're looking at volcanic activity. The Cascades...
Oh, yeah, the scientists say the magma is moving.
Yeah, and the Cascades is a target area. You know, for over 20 years now, Mount Rainier has been one of my little pinpoints on my map to watch for the activity. Like, you know, if we had to pick a benchmark and say, what is a final stage before we see, you know, unprecedented changes, and that was Mount Rainier, the eruption of Mount Rainier. When Mount St. Helens went off, we felt that it was close, and that has not happened as yet. So that's another area that I'm really focusing on. But I see that whole section under great stress, as I see the Midwest, the New Madrid fault regions. I still see that under stress right now. So these are areas that I think within the next 6 months we're going to see some release of energy, probably quakes first, and then volcanic action thereafter.
Is it going to be, once you're certain that it has begun, whatever that sign might be, then how rapidly does it unfold, or are these events yet far apart?
They're a series. I mean, if we were to look back 10 years, we'll say, and looked at the Earth and changes, we would say, you know, it's long-term. Yet, if you know, we saw what happened in the 90s. It's just been unprecedented. You know, the quakes are deeper in the ground. They're larger in magnitude. We've got glaciers melting. You know, we have a significant change in the Earth that says these things have already begun. The changes I see are continual and building, kind of like going up a hill. It's kind of like that kind of an action. And then along that way, along that pathway, there are great changes, and then a pulling back, a resting time period, and then more great changes. So these will occur over the next 10 years, where you'll see some major ones, and then quieting down, and then more major ones, and then culminating somewhere around 2012 with kind of a final change, where we see land masses literally separated, you know, new maps of the world.
Yes, I have your map, of course. It's going to be a very different world, and a lot of it's not going to be here anymore, at least as far as human beings are concerned. I suppose the Earth will continue to rotate, but it'll just be a whole new plan, won't it?
It changed. I mean, the Earth has gone through these changes before and survived, and it will survive again.
Oh, the Earth will survive.
The Earth will survive. The Earth does not go away. It will be there. It's just like, you know, when a hurricane comes across and we move off land or we lose an island, you know, people migrate and we continue on. The kind of changes we're talking about, of course, involve a lot of people. But if you were one of the people living on one of the islands that are currently going through volcanic activity, it's your whole world. So, you know, we tend to think of changes as happening someplace else, until it happens, you know, to us, like what? 9/11, for example.
Well, that's where I was going next. A lot of people, of course, have said, why don't people like yourself, why did you not, in fact, see the 9/11 event? It's so such a gigantic event in human history anyway, certainly, that that it should have been obvious to somebody who sees these events in time unfolding ahead of us.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think that that anybody who is sensitive, that we all should have clearly seen that thing coming. You know, many of us, myself included, saw it coming to a particular area and saw that it was going to happen, but we didn't see where, the date, the time, or the level of the damage. We just didn't, the loss of life. We didn't see that, and we should have. And the only thing I've ever noticed is that when some event like this occurs, and it's so dynamic, you know, it's not like a get out of jail free card for an intuitive, but sometimes we're not supposed to see it. And that's it. You know, I've used to do medical readings, and there'd be times when I just could not read a person at all, and just couldn't do it. And we would try several different times, days, months, just couldn't do it.
And you have no idea why.
Well, I did. I realized after that it was part of the karma of the person. It would only happen, you know, maybe 1 in 10 or 12 times, where I just wouldn't get enough details about it. And then as time would go on, I would later learn that, you know, it was part of their experience. We would all like to be 100% accurate. We would all like to see everything and see all the details. And sometimes we're only given bits and pieces of it.
Well, now you've got the 9/11 event that has occurred, and now we do face a very uncertain future. I mean, we're on the brink of war in all probability.
Well, we are at war.
We're at war, in a sense, certainly. We face the probability of another attack on this country of some horrible nature. So are you able to look ahead at this situation from this point?
It's probably one of the areas since 9/11 that I've tried to tune into, and I have released a lot of information to a lot of different places and agencies. Some of them I think have been fruitful, where the information has been able to maybe you know, stop certain things from happening or put it off. But if a group is determined, regardless of what we see, they're going to accomplish it. So there are more attacks that will come to this country. It's inevitable. I don't see anything, however, I said this 3 or 4 months ago, I don't see anything occurring during this window, this time cycle. However, come spring, I think we're in a high-risk time period again, where we may see changes like that. I don't think it'll come from planes. I think the next thing we're going to see has to do with shipping. It's either shipping or transportation, like trains but more ships. For some reason, I've been getting a lot of information that some types of ships, especially on the West Coast, coming in.
I know they've been watching ships really carefully.
Yeah, they're watching everything, and of course, that whole process is going to increase as far as the watch goes. I mean, there's a major effort right now, and you know, we don't know where they are or when they're going to hit. If you watch television, CNN, and watch what goes on in Israel, you know, some small version of that will more than likely occur here in North America.
By that you mean
more of solo attacks rather than.
Major events.
Major events, yeah.
You know, one has to wonder why that has not really already occurred. The sniper thing, of course, but...
I think that a lot of it has to do with profiling, whether we agree with it or not. You know, if you're in the Middle East, you cannot tell, for the most part, you know, by language, ethnicity, you just can't tell. You don't know who the good guys and the bad guys are.
Yeah.
So here in the country, of course, whether we want to admit it or not, there's a definite profiling going on, and so we, you know, that can be targeted and watched.
By the way, it's probably off the beaten course here, but we just passed some legislation that's pretty invasive stuff. I mean, yeah, the threat is big, and I just wonder if I could get your take on it. A lot of people are saying privacy out the window here. I mean, they're going to be looking at everything, you know, all the emails, all the everything. They're going to start keeping track of everything.
Well, I'm not sure that doesn't hasn't already existed, but
yeah.
Yes. When, you know, the argument will be when you're at war, things like this are needed. You know, we have been very fortunate that we haven't had any attacks since 9/11. Many of them have been foiled, and probably a lot of them we won't even know about what's happened until some later time. As far as our individual personal, like our email accounts or our checking accounts, things of that nature, unless some flag comes up, I don't think it's going to affect us as citizens very much. It's just knowing the fact that somebody is looking over your shoulder. You know, it's the big brother concept, which it bothers me, but I don't feel like, I mean...
If you were in the decision-making seat and you had to say yes or no to a program of this magnitude that would virtually look at everything, based on the current threat that you do know about, would it be sufficient for you to authorize such...
No, it wouldn't be. It wouldn't be for me. I think we need safety valves. We need controls. You know, I liken it to search warrants. You know, there has to be some process of justification for doing things, and I think that to preserve our own personal lives, we need to do that. I know when war goes on, you know, it's the rally cry that we have to defend. And while that is true, I think there may be other ways of doing that. I think there has to be safeguards established, and I don't see those now.
All right. One other question. How fragile is everything? And by that I mean the Al-Qaeda people seem to believe that our economy in America, or even the world's economy, which catches a cold when we sneeze, is fragile enough that if they initiate one terrible thing, one atomic bomb goes off, one radiation bomb goes off, hundreds of thousands are killed by a biological attack of some sort, or millions even, whatever it is, they manage to do something really big, it would, whatever else it would do, it would destroy the American economy.
We withstood 9/11.
You're true.
And took a hit, a big hit.
Yes.
We withstood the dot-com meltdown, which was an enormous hit. Another one, I mean, there's a, if we look back, let's say 3 years, we can see that we've taken major, major hits. You know, I'm more concerned right now about other things that are going on. Our trade deficit is just out of sight. Unemployment is just really climbing. We don't have true numbers of that because people have been out of work for so long that they're not included in the numbers.
That's right.
The economy itself...
Is it that fragile? Could they bring it down?
Yeah, we are at the point where a terrorist attack on the country would definitely take a hit with us, but I don't think in it of itself would do it. I think it would be another piece of the domino falling. We are headed for a repeat of the 1929 time period.
Hold on, Gordon. Gordon Michael Scallion is my guest, a repeat of 29. From the high desert, I'm Art Bell.
Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye. From west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222 or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network.
It is indeed Gordon Michael Scallion as my guest. We are shortly going to be talking about possession. But a repeat of 1929, the Great Depression, around the corner. You think people are ready for that one? Once again, here's Gordon Michael Scallion. Well, a repeat of 1929 is really serious stuff. Most Americans today, of course, have absolutely no idea how serious, do they, Gordon?
I think there's the group that is aware of this is increasing daily, especially those who are employed. I mean, it's hard not to watch news. In my type of work, I'm forced to. Lots of times I would just not like to at all. But, you know, when we see, major layoffs and companies, just belling up, we're also seeing a cost of living increase that's been going on. These are tough times. Housing is a major problem right now, as I see it, and it's going to become worse. Wages is another serious problem. We're going to start seeing more and more unions taking action. In the past, they've made major concessions just to keep companies going. Delta right now is going through a change where they're asking their employees and their pilots to take pay cuts. So the average person, I think, is becoming more aware of it. How severe, I don't think that anybody really sees that yet.
Yeah, what would you recommend to people, knowing what's coming? What would you say to them? What should they be doing?
Yeah, my advice that I've been sharing for years was the same whether we're heading for this or not. I just think that everybody needs to get their house in order for your own mental state and your own well-being. One of the biggest difficulties that I've learned through my seminars and teachings has been that many families that have difficulties, finance is right up on the top of the list of things that cause additional stress. So I tell people, if you have a home, try to, get your mortgage down as low as possible. Get your cost of living down as low as possible. Credit card debt is staggering. The average family, it's well over $10,000 right now. And the average family has multiple credit cards, all pretty much maxed out. All of that's going to come tumbling very shortly for everybody. So get your debt down wherever you can. Rethink whether you need, if you're about to make a major purchase, rethink that purchase. So the main things are, I find, is your house. If you have some money or you have a windfall or you're able to do it, get your mortgage down. Those who are fortunate enough to pay it off, it's a good thing to do. If you have a business of some type, instead of investing in the markets or bonds or CDs, invest in your own business. Mm. You have a better control over that.
That's true.
I think that people right now should be in a very strong cash position whenever possible. I know there's a huge number of people out there who are waiting for the market to rebound. And they just said, well, it always comes back. It has, for the past umpteen years, it's always come back if you wait.
And your view?
And it hasn't, and I don't think it will. I don't think we're going to see a return to the highs that we had in the 90s. I think we're into a whole new economy, and we're going to have new levels that will become the norm. So I'm not suggesting that people, bail at this time, but I do suggest that people try to get into a cash position, reduce your costs as much as possible, and rethink major purchases, and very definitely reduce credit card debt as much as possible.
Yeah, okay. All that makes sense. For some reason, one of the main subject you wanted to cover tonight, I found very interesting, the subject of possession. And I wonder how Gordon Michael Scallion got to even considering, thinking about, or wanting to talk about possession.
Yeah, it's not a subject that, as you know, I have mentioned it in different places, but it's not been a prime subject that I have addressed. And the reason that I haven't is that I did not in the past see it as a crisis thing. It's one of those things that we've always experienced. It's always been with us. It's usually been small and quiet, and unless it's become sensationalized, in some form through a movie or something. But right after the D.C. sniper shootings, stuff started flooding into my consciousness nonstop. And it went on for like 3 days. I doubt if I had more than an hour's sleep in those 3 days. And it was at that stage I said, well, and I was meditating, and in my meditation it said, you know, shortly you'll be contacted by Art, and this is the subject, should he call, you should discuss. And so I trust my guidance, and so I have a lot of information to share about that and things that we can do, because I see that as just as serious as earth changes or economics or anything.
All right. I can briefly tell you what little I know about possession. You know, in doing this program, I interviewed Father Malachi Martin.
Sure.
Father Martin was way high up in the Catholic Church. He did exorcisms in the city of New York. He's now passed away, of course, but one of the things he impressed very heavily on me, publicly and privately as well, was the amount of increase in possession. He was noting an average, Gordon, of about 800% increase in his area in New York every year. 800%.
Yeah, and you know the real number is staggering. I mean, those are the number of people who found their way to him.
That's correct. Yes, those are his numbers. Yes, yeah. I know. But obviously, it's an indicator that something's happening.
It is, and it's a subject that for at least a millennium has always been in the hands of primarily of Catholicism, not exclusively, but it was something that the church dealt with as one of the things that they could do to protect, you know, their parishioners. And so, you know, when something came up, it was, let's get a Catholic priest in. And yet, my experience has been that all religions are dealing with this, and they're dealing with this in a significant way. Every day here at our institute, we receive between 100 and 300 letters on an average day. After your show, we'll probably get 5 or 10,000.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have a staff that goes through all those, and we database them, and we try to do whatever we can do with our limited resources. But one of the things that we're seeing that's coming more and more is that people are trying to figure out what's really going on in this crazy world. Everybody says, you know, the world is going crazy. Things are never going to be the same again. 9/11 drove that home, put it in their consciousness, but when they start looking deeper, they see problems at other levels. They see other things that are going on that are upsetting. And in my opinion, these things are really being driven by forms of possession. And possession is not simple. There are many levels of it, many forms of it.
All right. Let's see if we can define some terms. Do you believe, Gordon, that there is a Lucifer, a Satan, an anti-God?
There is a collective consciousness, and Lucifer has been in my readings for years as a true past personality. In other words, in the physical at one time, not only in the spirit world. And then, so that does continue. I do believe that there is, just as there's the Christ, there's the Antichrist.
Yes.
You know, so there is this band, if you will, of negativity. Most of it that I've experienced, and I have been called in numerous times, especially in the 80s and 90s, to work with possessed cases. And I always did it quietly. I never published it.
I was not aware of that.
Yeah, I did. That was part of the work that I did. I worked with religious leaders, and many times it was not just Catholicism, but it was a significant amount in Judaism that we found. But it was there, but it was always there. And to me, it wasn't something that was out of the realm. It was just that negativity and evil does exist. As much as I wanted to deny it, you know, my hopes were that we focus on the light or the brighter part, and don't give the negative part any energy. And so that was always my philosophy. Yet this has been building and building, and now it is, in my opinion, it is massive.
Is the source of possession from Lucifer, from his minion, from, I don't know, for lack of a better phrase. I mean, from that, it's from that negative side, obviously, but is it specifically from what we think of as Lucifer and from his minion?
In 21st century, you know, we want to give names to things, and we would see this as, we can identify it as Lucifer. From the way I see it and interact with it, it's a collectiveness, and if we want to call it Lucifer, we can, but Lucifer is just a
name.
It's a driving force. It's a portion of it, just as Hitler and Stalin were a part of that. Some of them have called them antichrists. It's a negativity which is evil. It's a separation. They're so separated from the light that dark is normal for them. They don't see the light. And this consciousness, this Luciferian force, if you will, is like a big database that everybody who has a similar vibration can tap into it. Or people who just aren't aware. I mean, if you're into drugs or alcohol or experimenting with the occult in the wrong ways, you tap into this database. Once you make this connection, even with thoughts, especially with thoughts, this database starts to feed you information. Uh-huh. And now, this is when you really have to watch out for it. And because it can literally, truly possess you.
Is that, Gordon, what happens to people like, you know, in the sniper case, the one thing that's still missing for me is any understanding of why. I don't think anybody's really recited exactly why all of this happened. It just happened. I mean, this guy decided he wanted, these people decided they wanted to start killing people, randomly killing people. And why?
Well, you know, the profilers and the psychologists will look at it one way, and the shrinks will look at it a slightly different way. And, you know, basically what we see is a young man, and so that we're going to say he was a troubled young man, and it's his childhood, or it's this or that. And in what I see is that it was somebody who was angry, very angry, but angry to the point where it wasn't vented outward. It was kept inward. And so there was this internal anger just built and built. And once it reached a certain threshold, it spilled over and it allowed a possession to occur. And
well, whatever it was, had to eclipse reality for that person.
Yeah, for him, it becomes, it's just like, you know, it's hard for us to understand a suicide bomber.
Right.
You know, how could the young people, men and women, young girls, young men, how could they do that? You know, we would say, well, they're brainwashed. You know, but somewhere back there's a cause. There's, you know, there's from other people, there's this cause that they become part of, and then eventually their life becomes of little value. So when the human soul sees little value in itself, it becomes susceptible to influence. And that's what happened to him. His soul literally dimmed, and it allowed negative forces to come in. And he was acting almost in a justifiable way. I am, you know, I'm doing this because it's the right thing to do. You know, we have this cause. And eventually this will come out. I mean, eventually we'll hear, you know, after the movie is made and the books are written,
yes,
we're going to find out that you know, basically he will say that he's not really sure why he did it, but that it was something that he was driven to do. You'll hear that statement, driven to do.
Yeah, and you imagine that this will be seen, or that you will see this, at least, or see it now, as a case of possession, and we will eventually either see it that way, too, or regard him. I suppose you can easily put people like this just into the mental category. Boom.
It'll come out as that he was, it was a form of childhood brainwashing. I mean, that's how it will emerge into the media. You know, it's a form of childhood brainwashing. Is what will, those phrases are. Usually, I can pick up phrases from headlines or articles that are going to appear in the probable future. And those are some of the phrases that I got in that 3 days. So you know, for him, it was that he will say over and over again that you know, he's not sure. He's not sure why. It's something he had to do.
And you think there will be more and more of this kind of random insanity? I mean, to us, it seems insane, certainly.
It is, and, you know, we also have to look at, you know, we all want to kind of get a glimpse of the future, at least to see where we're heading. And so, what you know, if you're a forecaster or an intuitive, you're trying to paint a probable future, and then we see what happens. But we also have to look back a short time period. You know, we've got Columbine. You know, we've got school shootings around this country.
Absolutely.
And not just, you know, one or two. We're talking about
many,
a lot of them. And the reason that this is happening, and this, by the way, this cyber case is just one more piece of that same. What I would call, I'll call it an evil force. It's a collective, it's a very specific collective force.
Let's deal with this for just a second. I mean, you really hit on something that I've wanted to talk about. I have talked about it to a limited degree. I call them head shakers, where people just walk into an office, kill everybody in the office, or with a gun start shooting teachers or students, or all the things that have been going on, or the latest being the sniper thing. All of this stuff, I've been looking at it for a few years now, seeing it drastically increase and saying to the audience, you know, I think, you know, this really is something happening now. In other words, I don't remember as a child growing up, you know, in the 50s, I don't remember these headlines. Or if they were there, they were so tiny as to be just infinitesimal compared to the number of things going on now. And people say, well, you can attribute it to the media. You know, the media just didn't report this kind of thing like that then. I don't think I believe that. In other words, I think we're really seeing something new, and you've got to wonder where it's coming from, and I guess you know.
Well, the media did report on it, but the cases were far and few between. You know,
indeed.
We're in the communications revolution right now. In fact, we're almost through it, in my opinion. But and the only difference between, then we had radio, we had newspapers, and newspapers had two editions a day. So instead of watching television every hour, so we get it a little faster now. But there was all kinds of media in the 50s. I mean, in the 50s, you could, at least where I came from, you could, as a child, someone 7 years old, I mean, I could walk up and down the streets a day or night, and I always felt safe.
Yeah, okay, so I don't remember that either. It wasn't happening then. This is something relatively new.
And the reason for the changes today is the change in society. As a collective society, we have stressed ourselves beyond imagination. We have stressed ourselves first with the Cold War. You know, after World War II, we were terrified that we were going to have a nuclear Holocaust world. And many people back then, I can remember just saying, I'm going to do everything because I may not be alive tomorrow. And I can remember, friends of mine who were in college who had that philosophy. Again, we may not be alive tomorrow, so I don't care. I'm going to just do what I want to do. So we had the Cold War stress, and then we had a whole new stress where we changed technologies. We moved into this new technology era, which meant that everybody had to retrain themselves for computers. And if you were, getting close to retirement or even 20 years before retirement, you really had to hustle really quickly to become proficient if you wanted to get a job or keep a job. Then you had the population explosion, which forced the society to expand and try to create new jobs
and now,
new programs.
And now we have terrorism.
And now we have terrorism. It's just one more stress. Plus, we can add to this whole case is I can remember the predictions of the 50s from the think tanks. That
Gordon, got to hold it. We're right here at the top of the hour. We'll be right back. Time, indeed. Of us. So the stress has come to the breaking point. I'm Art Bell.
Call Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
Good morning. Gordon Michael Scallion is here. And there's something in his voice tonight. We'll talk more about that in a moment. Stay right there. We're talking about, of all things, possession. Once again, here is Gordon Michael Scallion. And I've been interviewing Gordon for years, but tonight I hear, I hear an edge in your voice tonight that I'm unaccustomed to, Gordon. Something, it's kind of like something you know, something you're talking all around, something that you know and you haven't quite fully said yet. there's an edge there that I'm trying to identify.
Well, it's, you are, of course, highly perceptive. Part of what's happening tonight is I'm, for some reason, and this has not happened in more than, 10 years we've been doing this,
mm-hmm.
I'm dipping in and out of a higher state of consciousness. I'm not sure why that is. So that's part of it. And the other part is that, when you're looking at things, like when I was looking at things in the 80s, 81, 82, everything seemed so far away. You know, it was things that were going to happen at the turn of the century and beyond. And so it was way out there. And I could, kind of live a semi-normal life. Now we're getting closer to all these things that I saw occurring.
And
then there's this feeling like, I want to get a bunch of Band-Aids and quickly go out and put them on.
Yeah, it's like it's all unraveling. Here it goes. Yeah. You can actually see the beginning of the unraveling. I agree with that. But possession, I mean, is that part of the way it's going to end up? I mean, it's going to become a Mad Max world, in a world in which more and more people are going to begin doing things that the rest of us, or those left, simply don't understand. Period.
Well, anytime there's a crisis of any type, whether it's a major earthquake, 9/11, any kind of a crisis, wars, we see that it brings out the worst and the best of humankind. We'll see people who you would never think would be heroes become heroes. People laying down their lives for others that you would not think normally would do this. So, we're kind of in that point of a crisis, a battle, if you will, between dark and light, and that's manifesting itself in all avenues.
Then you also, though, probably have like some scientist out there taking a batch of nasty stuff and putting it in envelopes and seeing how many people he can kill.
Yeah, and these actions will continue. The big question that I receive every single day is what can we do? How do we keep our lives balanced? And when I grew up, in the 50s. We had our family had a very strong church tie,
mm-hmm.
and so I was active in it, and then later in life, I moved in a different direction, but kept my own personal spirituality, and which I practice every single day, and I think that's what we've lost. We've lost the fact that we don't take some time, even a few minutes every day, just to stop. Stop the insanity and just stop and kind of, go within to our spiritual center and try to find that balance point. Because whenever there's a showdown of consciousness, which is what is happening right now, the war is going to escalate it. I believe it's going to spill over to many regions of the Middle East. And all of that is going to drive home more fear. And fear is the key element for possession.
The showdown of consciousness. I'm going to remember that's a good one, Gordon. Does an individual know that the process of possession is beginning?
No. There are different types of possession. There's possession by agreement, which are mediumistic activities.
Mm-hmm.
There's possession by non-agreement, when an outside entity influences you, and those are rarely ever known. And in fact, even as it gets deeper into it, it's not known unless somebody begins that way, where somebody is experimenting, we'll say, with the occult. And if you're not prepared, you're open, really open, to having things go wrong. So it's doubtful in the beginning, middle, or the end that a person is ever aware of possession.
Aside from those that experiment with and or invite what occurs to them, I wonder how much additional possession is going on. Apparently quite a bit, and not all of it so willingly.
No, and as I said earlier, there's different levels of possession. We have on the one extreme is where you have very powerful unclean spirits, if you will. They are kind of like searchers. They just search for an energy that's similar to them, a negativity that's in there.
Mm-hmm.
Things like fear, depression, anger, hatred, bitterness, these are things that are like little lights that they're drawn to.
And hence, so you were saying before the news, the stress level of modern society is really at a very serious peak right now, and it certainly is. I don't see how it could get much higher. I guess it can.
It can, and it will.
And it will, yeah.
It will. In the next 24 months, we're going to see what I believe will be a crescendo or a peaking of that. And then after that, I think we're going to see a different kind of a tapering off. We're, you know, so much of what goes on in the world is governed by celestial beings, if you will, by planetary influences. You know, we know that if you're going for surgery, we know you don't want to go on a full moon. And there's enough data that supports that. And we also know that certain planets create certain conditions. So next year is going to be a very prime year for possession. It will really take hold, and a lot of it has to do with Mars will be closer to Earth than it's been in over a century.
I think 50,000 years, closer than it's been in 50,000 years is what I heard.
Yeah. Okay, and it's going to be significant. It's going to be significant in that it's going to trigger Earth changes, and it's also going to be significant in it is that, you know, in Roman myth, it's the god of war.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we're looking at war. I believe it'll occur sometime probably in February, March, April time period. And we're also looking at a time period where we're going to see financial stress, and we're going to see a major outbreak of possession. Possession is going to literally make it to the media next year.
Oh, really?
Where it hasn't been other than as thriller shows, you know, but we're actually going to see that surfacing.
How does possession actually work? How does it happen? How does it manifest?
A lot of the possession that I dealt with individuals, as I got into it, I discovered that it really wasn't possession. It was something else, but in a similar fashion. But let's say possession that takes over a body.
Yes.
Where all of a sudden the person becomes evil. The way it works is that you have an entity which we would call this as a lost soul, we'll say. And that soul is attached to a much larger consciousness, the Luciferian force, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like a member of it. It draws its strength from it, and it looks for those conditions where it can attach itself to. And it does it on a technical basis. It does it through the body's etheric field, or the body double. So the etheric body can be thought of as a model of our human shell, if you will, one that can't be seen with the naked eye.
Yes,
can only be seen, you know, clairvoyantly. But it enters through the etheric field, and it is able to impress through the spinal column up to the brain and influence that individual. It can come and go. It can come from it can work in dream states. It can work in the full awareness. But when it totally takes over the body, there's a real clear aura that you can see of it. You see the double aura, and you can see this other force attached to the back. So if I look at somebody from the front, I can see this other form attached to the body like a double aura almost.
You can actually see that?
You can see it. It can be seen. And many of the Catholic priests that I had worked with in the early 80s were able to see flashes. And the things that they would describe was exactly what I was seeing. So that's when I knew that this was a serious condition. Most of the times I did not see that, and I realized that it wasn't possession. It was somebody really had gone back into their own past life, and that past life personality was now becoming dominant. So it was mistaken for possession. And once we worked through that, everything was fine, and the person went back to a normal life.
Wouldn't possession most normally be mistaken for schizophrenia?
Schizophrenia is a classic case, very classic case of it, where because the nervous system itself is weakened in many areas, and the circuitry is like an open circuit, and so it allows the endocrine glands, and particularly the ones that are the pineal in particular. Though not exclusively, that particular gland is very susceptible, very open, and so they can get in. And when you see a person having an epileptic fit,
yes,
the person could be epileptic regardless of possession. But when possession comes in, that personality can really change. And I have seen that. It's like some evil force preying on someone who's not well.
Is a person who is not well physically, and I suppose mentally as well, an easy also target?
Not so much physically. I mean, most of the physical difficulties I see with people, and I say see is orally speaking, they are physically not well because of some particular personality issues in their lives. So illness is driven by our thoughts and our karma and our current life's experiences. So when we get ill, we need to also look at what are our issues in life. If we discover those issues, then a lot of our illnesses go away. In my case, I had chronic asthma as a child, was on respirators constantly,
mm-hmm.
and it wasn't until after I had my first metaphysical experience 79, and a few years later, I was able to discover why I still had asthma. I couldn't even go out in the winter without a scarf on my face. And once I realized what that was, I was able to eliminate it literally in a microsecond, and it totally went away. So in my case, it was a karmic issue that I was able to face and deal with. Most people, ill health is not in its of itself a reason for possession.
But putting yourself even beginning to think about these things, I've wondered about that frequently. You know, we talk about these things on the air frequently, and I have sort of come to the conclusion that talking about them, or go considering them, even opens a kind of a door.
It's possible. It can, but it's the continual thoughts, the continual thought stream of your own personality, day after day, hour after hour, throughout the week, months, and years. This is what sets up your vibration. So if you dwelled on that constantly, that was in your thoughts constantly, then you indeed can open yourself up to those kind of conditions. But if it's how we live our lives and how we're in service, all these things, you know, it's a natural protection for you. But if you're thinking about negative things and you're thinking about doing negative things, this certainly opens you up.
Well, it must be then a slow, insidious process for those who become possessed a little more and a little more and a little more, and the thoughts turn darker and darker and darker until they finally manifest in reality.
That's exactly what happens.
Huh.
It's something that transpires over usually long time periods. It can, on rare occasions, happen instantly, but typically it is something that just happens over a long time period.
Now,
and it doesn't have to happen to anybody.
You said that it'll become so widespread that it'll break into the mainstream media. So that would mean that the process must be well underway, very well underway by now, with many, many out there.
There is, and, you know, usually we have kind of a self-protection in each of us. Somewhere in our consciousness, we all have some type of a faith system that we believe in, and it's that faith system that continually protects us. When we lose faith, when stress gets so far out there that we just don't have any time to think about faith
mm-hmm.
or believe it, then we get susceptible. So the stress of the consciousness collective is what will determine the amount of these experiences. And as we said earlier, the stress is on the rise, and it will increase substantially next year and the year after. So with this kind of stress, we will see different conditions. And you're going to actually be reading in the paper. You'll remember this conversation that the people will actually, there'll be a trial case where somebody will say, it wasn't my client's fault. He was possessed because of society's failure.
Mm-hmm. Because of society's failure. So in other words, you're taking this back down, you're taking this back to the collective consciousness.
Yes.
And you're saying the collective consciousness is turning so sour right now because of the mass stress, everything that we're going through, that it's turning so negative.
It's dividing. Maybe it was 4 or 5 years ago, we talked about the fact that I saw a polarized world coming in the 90s, in the late 90s. I said, we're going to enter into a polarized world somewhere around 97, 98, where the world kind of divides up into two corners. And we can call these corners light and dark or whatever we want. But it's like this, like the collective consciousness has two sides of it. And during the time periods of, you know, there's a prophesized millennium of peace coming, which I agree with. And I agree with it because the collective consciousness, the scales turn in favor of light, and therefore we have a better world because more people get it. More people get the fact that we need a spiritual connection.
But this doesn't come until after some rather major events.
That's true. It's all part of it. This is kind of like the showdown, if you will, or the final shakeup of people deciding who they really are, what they are, what's important, what's not important. It's a deciding time period. You know, we could call it judgment, but the judgment is really a self-judgment. You know, we're part of this collective consciousness, and we decide what ball team we want to play on.
But it doesn't seem like we have a choice of teams. Hold it right there. What ball team we're going to play on, huh? We'll pick it up right there. That's very interesting. I'm Art Bell. This is Coast to Coast AM with Gordon Michael Scallion roaring through the nighttime. What team do you think you're going to be on? Probably going to be on our team, because what choice are you going to have?
Let me let you in on a little secret that I shared with the After Dark subscribers just a few months back. I really don't believe everything that my guests talk about here on the show. You heard right, I'm a skeptic. But once in a great while, a guest comes along who just blows my socks off and forces me to rethink my conclusions about something. Now that's what happened when I talked to Pam Reynolds. Read about her story in the May issue of the After Dark newsletter. Subscribe now by calling toll-free 1-888-727-5505. For just $39.95, you get two free issues, 14 for the price of 12. Or log on to artbell.com, hit the library link to the secure server to order. This issue may change the way you think, too. Call now, 1-888-727-5505.
I'm Art Bell. I just happen to be in the neighborhood, so I drop by to extend a special invitation for you to join me Sunday for Dreamland. It should be a great show. My guest will be Dr. Eldon Taylor.
The topic? Subliminal perception.
Don't miss it. Sunday, Greenland, right here on everybody's favorite radio station.
Kingdom of Nye. From west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222 or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network.
This is interesting. Paula in Salt Lake City, Utah writes, "Hey Art, what you're hearing in Gordon Michael Scallion's voice is unadulterated fear." We were talking about what team, you know, everybody has to start deciding what team they're on, but it seems to me the decision is pretty much made for us. I mean, it's... to me, it's simple. For example, that which lies directly in front of us right now, the war that we are about to have, what we experienced with 9/11, the people who want us dead, that's all it seems they want. They want us dead. I suppose in an ideal world, they would like us converted, but they probably decided we're not converting, so now they want us dead. And so what choice is there? I mean, it seems to me that we are on the path to war. We are going to have a war, and we are going to kill before we're killed, or we're going to kill in retaliation for what happened to us, but there's going to be this war, and I don't see how you can choose any other team. Gordon?
Well, there, you know, we've had people from this country who chose another team.
Oh, we have, yes, it's true.
And, you know, when things get tight and tough. Like I said, you know, we enter this polarized world where we see the best and worst of us. And so, you know, it's if there's a shortage of food, there's going to be a problem. And so it's not necessarily that, you know, the bad guys are over there in the other side of the world. It's just that they're everywhere. You know, it's a case where society has kind of lost its spiritual fiber, and it's trying to get it back, and it's there's a lot of people working very hard to get it back, and I think that that it will triumph eventually. You know, eventually we're going to see brighter days, much brighter, better than perhaps any time in our planet's history is coming. But not before we have this this shakeout.
Can anybody be possessed?
Theoretically, anybody could be possessed. A lot of people do it daily, and not in a negative way either. Possession, we tend to think of as a you know, unclean spirit that's possessing our body and mm-hmm. influencing us. Mm-hmm. And while that is one definition of it, there are other levels of possession which can be benevolent, but it is not for the faint at heart. It's not for the experimenters.
Give me an example.
Well, for example, in the 80s and 90s, channeling was very popular, and it was a repeat of the spiritualist movement of the turn of the century, the 20th century. And so that cycle came back again governed by astrological forces, and also people who were willing to experiment with communications. So that communications in deep meditative states, deep trance states, you open yourself up for somebody to come through and talk to you. Now, depending upon your individual training and your belief systems and your spiritual center, you would draw in, hopefully, benevolent forces. But if you're just experimenting, like with a Ouija board or something like that, and without the training, you don't know what you're going to get. It's kind of like dialing a phone number, and you don't know, you know, who you're going to get on the other line. So that's a case where it's possession by agreement, where you are seeking consciously a communications with some other entity. So that's an example right there.
When did this process of essentially mass possession begin? Do you know how long ago it began?
I think it started in the early 60s. It began as society began to experiment. We began to look and see things differently. We weren't willing to accept what came before us. We wanted to express ourselves in different ways as a society. So the society, at least in America, became a society of entrepreneurship, business at all costs, profit at all costs. And we then started to divide, where unions came in because they said we need to form a union to protect ourselves. We need to have rights. And so we began to divide up in the workplace. We began to divide up in society. We had the sexual revolution. We had the anti-war. So if we look back, we see, you know, Vietnam. We see that whole time period, and that's where the level of consciousness, at least the negativity part of consciousness, got a foothold. It's not that it wasn't there and always has not been. It's always been there. Mm-hmm. But it was enough mass, if you will, where it was able to awaken, if you will, a lot of the negative forces that were out there. And the negative forces then said, oh, I'm out of my sleep. There is now plenty of bodies which we can begin to look at. And so we have the drug movement. Everybody's experimenting. And if you read a lot of the transcripts of that time period of people who were tripping, you know, it reads like a fantasy sci-fi story. But if you really read it, you can see the things that they're talking about is clearly some other personality that's involved that became part of that person.
And those people are now our leaders.
It's always the way that the people who are now suits.
They're now the suits. That's right. I don't know why I'm laughing. Do the people who are possessed now, many of them, to use Father Malachi Martin's phrase, perfectly possessed, are many of them aware of it? At some level, are they aware that it's not fully their consciousness and not fully their bidding that they're doing?
No. It's a rarity that that people are aware of it. I mean, I perhaps have been involved in maybe 100 such cases of possession and had a chance firsthand to actually experience a possession taking place. And
what have you seen?
I was... my wife and I were out in Arizona. We had some friends out there who found a house, and they asked me to come over and see their new house that they had purchased. And we went over to the house, and I walked into the house, and the woman turns to me, and she says, "Right," she says, "you just turned white as a ghost." She says, "Is there a ghost in this house?" And I said, "I don't know." I said, "But there's." I said, there's a real strange feeling in here." And I said, "If I didn't know better, I would say that the house is possessed." And I said, "I know you don't want to hear that." And she said, "Well, I was feeling something, but I didn't know what it was. This is really why I wanted you to come over." And I said, "Well, you know, have you closed on this house yet?" And she says, "No, we haven't closed on it." I said, "Well, why don't you give it some time?" I says, "And if your insights tell you to do it, do it. But why don't you give it some time?" Well, her future husband really wanted this house. I mean, he just wanted it. And he went ahead and bought it himself. Mm-hmm. And they moved in. And then about 3 months later, I get a call. And they said, "Would you come over? We're having a problem." So I went over, and once again, I walked in, and you know, turn white again, as she described it. And she says, I know you're seeing something. I said, well, I'm just seeing blood all over this floor. And I said, I don't know where it's coming from. And she says, well, she says, the reason I wanted you to come over here when my husband is not here is because he's changed. He's totally changed. And I said, well, you got to find out. I said, hopefully this blood doesn't mean something's going to happen. And I said, I think you got to find out about this house first of all. And so we left, and I get a call the next day, and she researched it, and she found out that the woman that was in the house was having an affair with someone else, and the husband came home and killed her on the kitchen floor, and she bled to death right there on the floor where I was seeing it. And so I said, well, what are you going to do? And she said, I want you to come over and talk to my husband, because I told him about this too. And she says, his eyes are just different. She says, and if you come, I know you'll see something. So I went over for dinner, and I looked at him, and truly, he was different. And so I looked at him, and I said, do you think you're the same person that you were 3 months ago?
Right.
And he says, of course I am. And so I said, do I have your permission to just come over and touch you on the shoulder? And I said, I wouldn't want to do anything without your permission, not even think about it. And he said, why? And I said, because I think that you've kind of picked up something, maybe from this house. And he said, sure. He said, that's nothing wrong with me. So I went over and I touched him on the shoulder, and he literally was thrown back maybe 5 or 6 feet, just like electric shock. He went back. The lights in the house went off. He hit the floor, the
wow.
exact same spot in the kitchen where the blood was.
Oh, wow.
She ran and got a flashlight, went to pick up the phone. The phone didn't work. Was going to call 911 because she thought he was badly injured. And lights came back on. You know, no circuit breakers, nothing. Lights just came back on. And I went over and helped him up. And his eyes were back to normal. And he says, I think we should buy this house.
What?
I said, what? I said, she says, oh, he must have hit his head. He says, no, I really think we should buy this house. And he was back 3 months ago.
Before he even made the decision?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And he did not for days believe any of it. He didn't believe any of the things that had transpired, where he had been, what he had done. It was just like a total block of that time period.
So it's like you knocked something out of him.
I don't know. I mean, I did not intentionally or consciously do anything.
I understand.
My insight was to go over and put my hand on his shoulder, and not knowing why to do that, but after you've been in this field for 20 years, you kind of follow those things.
Mm-hmm.
And the only thing I could think about is that it just discharged the possessed entity that was there.
At that instant? Did you feel anything?
I felt, when I hit it, I felt the shock. But, you know, you and I both work electronics, so we're not... not unfamiliar to getting shocks.
That's right.
So I felt that shock, and I was thrown back. Saw stars, you know, that kind of thing. You squeeze your eyes really closed, and even though the lights were out, I could see streams of light that seemed to be flowing into him, versus something that's flowing out of him. And I'm assuming that was other spiritual forces that were coming into the system. You know, once the negativity was out, it made room for, you know, malevolent forces to come in.
I'm curious, how did it then turn out? I mean, was that thing then gone from that locality?
It was gone. They remained in that house. I wish I could say it had a happy ending, but 3 years later, they divorced. And they divorced over money issues. And then they both went their separate ways. But as far as that time period and those issues were gone of what he just kept craving. One of the things that he did, he kept craving to eat raw meat. I mean, it would just cook it just barely, you know.
Yes.
But that was one of the things. And he wasn't a drinker at all, and he kept drinking gin. Just, you know, he'd buy a fifth of gin and drink it like nothing, like he would drink water. And it didn't seem to have any effect on him, according to her. He would just drink and eat. He just loved to eat meat. He no longer wanted to have other things, you know, like vegetables or a mixture or fish. He just wanted meat.
Boy, is that odd.
Yeah.
Is that the only case of its? You said you had about 100. I mean,
yeah, we had another case where we were invited to go to a wedding in the Gold Coast of Connecticut, out in the Greenwich area, and it was the reception was to be held at an inn, a 300-acre inn. The inn was a 200-year-old inn. It used to be a working farm at that time, and there were there actually were slaves that were on that property at that time. And we went into this reception, and we were late, and they had it was in the winter, and they had a huge fireplace, probably 6 to 8 feet across, one of these big, massive fireplaces in the main entrance to this inn.
Mm-hmm.
There probably were 150 people there. And around the fireplace, there were maybe 20 people that were just sitting there talking and having a drink, and we met some friends, and we started talking to them. And then all of a sudden, both Cynthia and myself started to get cold. And Cynthia says, boy, she says, you know, it must really be cold outside. She says, because I'm still shivering. And then I was feeling cold. I said, you know, I am too. I said, maybe we just get closer to this fire. And so we moved closer, and we still were freezing. So finally, I'm sitting there, and I'm talking to some people, and I hear this voice as clear as, you know, I hear your voice, and it says, come into the library. And I turned to Cynthia thinking, you know, did she hear this voice too? And she looked at me, and she says, I'm getting this feeling like we need to be someplace else in this house. And I said, well, I just heard a voice saying go to the library. So she goes over to one of the waitresses. She says, do you have a library in this house? And she says, no. She says, this is just an inn. And she says, okay. She comes back, and she says, no, there's no library. And I said, well, I wouldn't have had that unless there really was something. So I went over and talked to another person in the reservation desk there, and I said, this house used to have a library. And he says, yeah. He says, we did. He says, we now use this as kind of as a wine cellar area. He says, it's not chilled, but we keep it in here. And I said, where is it? He says, it's down the hall to the left. He says, but it's not open to the public. And I said, okay, thank you. So I came back to Cynthia and I told her, I said, yeah, well, I guess there was a library. And then I hear the voice again, please come now. So I said, well, I'm going to have to, you know, do this, violate this a bit. So I went over to the waitress and I said, I know that the library is off limits here. I said, but can I just take a peek in for a second? I said, she said, sure, go ahead. So that was good enough for me. And I walked down the hall and I opened it. And I could see all the different cases of wine that were there, and there in the back was this library. And I went over to the books. I said, isn't this strange? And now we were really cold. I mean, noticeably cold. And I hear this voice again, and it says, bottom shelf, third book, my diary. That's all it said. And so I told Cynthia, and Cynthia went over the shelf, went down the bottom, third book over, and took out this little tiny hardcover book that was dated, I think it was 1789, I think it was. I'm not positive about that, but close enough. She took it out and opened the book, and in the book is this poem in this really tiny handwriting. And so Cynthia read this poem, and the poem was written about this woman who lived in the house, describing the gardens and describing the fact that she loved one of the slaves that was there. And that she knew that her father would kill her if he ever found out. And then she goes on to say, I'm sure this will happen. And then the journal ends. That was the last entry.
I'm sure this will happen, as meaning, I will be found out. I will be killed.
Yes. And then we, so that's the only information we had. So then we went back in. I got a hold of the owner of the inn, and he's running around like crazy, of course. And I said, I know you're really busy. I said, how do we find out about the history of this inn? He says, there's a book that's been written about this inn. He says, you can get it over there. It's for sale.
About 20 seconds.
I went over, got the book, opened the book up, broke the book to the binding, talked about the death of the girl by an unknown accident that occurred on the farm, never solved the accident of why she was dead, And her little spirit that's been back there, I asked the guy, I said, tell me, I said, have you had any conditions here with people? He said, look, I don't want to talk about ghosts. He says, I've had enough of that here. And he walked away.
Stand by. We'll be right back. Gordon Michael Scallion is my guest from the high desert. I'm Art Bell. This is Coast to Coast AM.
Call Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
This night with Gordon Michael Scallion, a visionary and one of the real McCoys out there. Known him for a decade. Been doing shows here for a decade. Here tonight on the subject of possession. What's coming for the world? I wonder if we're ready. Once again, Gordon Michael Scallion. Gordon, I've had a lot of theoretical physicists on the show, really wild, good guys right at the top of their game, you know, co-founder of the string theory, those kind of people. Mm-hmm. And they are speculating about many dimensions, that there are many dimensions, perhaps as many as 11 dimensions or more, dimensions that we cannot see or sense, almost always, although there are those who say there's an exception to that. The theoretical, the scientists, they're saying they're there. They can't prove it yet, but they definitely believe they're there. People like yourself perhaps can see occasionally across and or into these dimensions, and it may well be that in one of these dimensions, these entities we're talking about reside. I don't know. Do you?
The answer is yes, but more than likely there are, the way it breaks down is that there's basically, at least on the Earth, there's 7 levels of consciousness. Within each of those levels, there are 7 sub-levels. So we could say on Earth there are 49. When we leave the Earth, we enter Mars or Venus or whatever, there's a different level of consciousness, different levels of, different layers, if you will. Mm-hmm. Now, in the lower layers, they're more dense, closer to the physical matter. So if you can imagine the Earth having 7 Earths, and where the second Earth, you can barely see it, you know, just barely, and then the third on, you can't see it. And each of these Earths, if you will, are kingdoms. They're places where souls can dwell. The lower levels of these, ones that are closer to Earth, is where we find most of the demonic forces. These are populated by those souls who have fallen during incarnations on Earth, and they find themselves in this kind of borderland of negativity.
These dimensions would be immediately below the physical?
Below or above, I guess you need a relative point, but let's just say
immediately adjacent to.
Yeah, it's like a layer. If we could see the Earth as a bottom layer,
uh-huh.
And then the next layer, moving up an ascension level, if you would, you have the second borderland and the third. They're also known as astral realms, is another term used in occultism.
Right.
These realms become packed. Now, as you have more and more people in the world, and obviously more deaths, many of these people between lives find themselves in this kind of an environment. And some of these never take on physical form, ever, never have. They just, from the beginning, they've fallen on that negative reality, a Luciferian force, if you will. And they're sitting there. Now, the reason that they're at that lower level, or the second level, is because it's closer to Earth in vibration. It's like a harmonic up from the Earth.
Gotcha.
And they're easier for them to prey, if you will, on those people who are unbalanced, or negative, in any way. So it's like a feeding ground. And in my book, I wrote about how at schools, I would see these red streams of energy around certain schools, especially in cities. And then I realized that it was a combination of things, not only the society, but the way we build schools, the pollution of the cities, the negativity. There was a whole bunch of things. A lot of that has improved, however, in the past 3 years. I've seen that portion lessening. As these events occur, we say, you know, why do we have these shootings? These are the senseless things. Well, lots of times we can take a negative action and turn it into a positive one by reevaluating how we do things in schools. And I think we did that. You know, we did the obvious things like we put metal detectors in and security guards, something we should never have been part of our system or our society. It wasn't when I grew up. Classroom was 30 people.
Yeah, so the talk show host that I used to know a long time ago would say, though, again and again, he would say, isn't that a Band-Aid on a bullet wound?
Yeah, it is. It's kind of to stop it now and then, because the political system for change is a long one. But whenever we have a crisis that raises its head and consciousness then looks at it and says, okay, this is out of balance, what do we do? And so, you know, there's the period of debate, argument, funding, and the whole nine yards, just like since 9/11, you know, the whole preparation for war now, all this took time. And it's the same thing with schools and bringing change into schools. It takes time. So lots of times, like I said, a negative action can turn into positive for other people. But in these realms, these lower realms, this is the feeding ground, if you will, for these forces. But they can only feed on those who literally have no light in them.
When you're on the street, when you're in the cities, and I don't think you go very frequently, but when you do, do you see a lot of attachments? Do you see now a lot of possession underway? I mean, something obviously brought you to the program tonight to talk about this.
Yeah.
Something out of the ordinary.
I don't see possession in the sense that we've been talking about directly, where you have a single entity who is possessing an individual, you know, has taken over the individual.
Yes.
What I do see, however, is a different form of possession. It's kind of a group negative consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
So if you could imagine that, let's say there are thousands or tens of thousands of lost souls, and people are praying for these lost souls constantly, trying to move them up to higher levels of consciousness away from this. But they're still there. There's still this group. And this group moves towards wherever there is a negativity. So what I see is these collective thought forms, if you will, of negativity that are being fed by individuals who are, I'll just use the word lost. Let's just say that they're lost. They're open to influence from the outside.
A lot of them have gone off the edge because of the pressures we talked about earlier.
Yes. Yeah, and the pressures are at all levels. It's not just, you know, doing well in school. The pressure is the influence of the home and the split homes. You know, we have a 50% divorce rate. We have single moms working very hard to try to make it happen and financially balance life. I mean, things have changed a lot, and it's very difficult for families now to, you know, they're in a basic survival mode. And in the process of that, if they give up their spiritual essence, if they don't acknowledge it, if they don't work with it, regardless of whether it's a religious system or not, it doesn't matter. What does matter is that there is a belief that there is a greater power that is good and benevolent, because then you draw from that source versus this negative source.
As somebody from Taft, California asks, does Gordon believe that people like Charles Manson, Jeffrey Dahmer, people like that are, in fact, possessed?
The Manson case I can talk about, because I did research on that, and I've had a series of experiences on it. Yeah. That particular case was not a case of direct possession, but a case of someone who was controlling And in the process of controlling, he drew to him those similar forces. So he was being possessed from the outside by a group, if you will, versus an individual. And the way you can tell is if you see them at trials, if you ever watch a trial, mm-hmm. you see people with no remorse.
Mm-hmm.
It means that possession is still working with them.
Oh, I've seen many of those. Many of those with no remorse whatsoever. In fact, a lot of headlines about no remorse. You know, he sat there stoically, even when the verdict was read, with absolutely no reaction on his face whatsoever. That kind of headline?
Yeah. It's that the darkness is so dark that they just can't see the light. It's
All right.
always present and available.
This war that we're about to engage in, it seems almost inevitable despite, you know, the fact that the stalling tactics are going on as I knew they would with Saddam saying, sure, come on in, take a look and all the rest of it. At some point, that'll break down and then we'll have the war. Now, if we go to war with Iraq, do you think that in the case of a war, there's possession not just on one side with the, in quotes, bad guys, but in order to have a war, I mean, it usually takes two to tango, right? And so is there possession going on both sides before a war can happen?
During the Gulf War, it was the first war since my opening in 79 that I was able to actually observe. I was able to observe the troops and people that I met and military leaders who I met. And so it was a time period where there were a lot of people who were writing me, both at all levels, we'll say, and asking for some insights. And so I can talk from that point of view versus like World War II or Korea or
okay.
Vietnam.
All right.
And what I found is that during that war, and maybe it was during all wars, I don't know, there's a tremendous outpouring of love and prayer from people back home. So you've got these prayer groups working, you've got families praying for them. That energy is substantial, and it typically overweighs the negative responses, which is the reason why that unjust wars usually end badly for example, during World War II, we can see what happened there. I mean, it was a classic case of mass possession, in my opinion. But there will be some negativity on from the good guys, but it's minimal in nature. Where the problems come in is when the soldiers come home. That's what I found. I found that after people came back, and I would meet with them, I would find that they were changed. You know, they were.
Oh yes.
You know, and that was heartbreaking for me, really heartbreaking. And I would see cases where they were so distraught, so angry in many cases too, that their personalities changed and they were being influenced from without. Many cases like that, and so those cases are relatively easy to turn around. The difficult cases are when something comes in and totally takes over a personality. That's a tough one. You know, there you're talking about exorcism or some form of metaphysical work.
Other than the brief experience you had in the house, have you ever seen a full exorcism?
I have. I've been part of one. There are several in New England who are. I guess their terms are ghostbusters, but they're people who work in haunted houses and work with demonic possessions within a house. And so there were several cases that I was called in on those. And nothing like Rosemary's Baby or that kind of a situation. But one case I experienced in Connecticut where they thought it was a possession, and it was a poltergeist activity. Through a spirit that was just really confused. I mean, totally confused, didn't even know it was dead. And it was influenced through this young girl who was going through her, I think she was 13, 12 or 13.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was influencing her, and she in turn was moving objects and blowing light bulbs. And so I witnessed all of that, and also talking in a different language, which he had, you know,
no
knowledge of. So I went in with a Catholic priest, and my role was just to observe. And we spent some time, and they went through it. So there's three meetings, and after the third meeting, nothing had really changed. And then they asked me for what my opinion was of it. Did they need more prayer? Do we need to consecrate? What do we have to do with it? And my suggestion did not go well. It wasn't accepted very well, which was that I think we needed to talk to the person who was influencing her.
Oh, really?
So they said they could not be part of that, but the family said, in desperation, we're going to agree to that, even though, you know, the church doesn't condone it. So I went in and we had a session, and I talked, and I found out what the difficulty was of why that person was still there and why it was influencing this girl. And it was nothing that she had done directly, other than the fact that she was going through a great hormonal change in her life. And reached that stage in her life where your parents don't know anything, and you hate them, and you know she was just going through a very confusing time in her life, which opened her up for this condition.
Did you know when you were speaking to this entity? Did you know as you talked to her when you made a breakthrough and you were no longer talking to her?
Yeah, she would start off by talking Polish. Person who had and I don't, and of course. It. So I would then say, I'm sorry, I don't speak Polish. And then the mother would come in, and the mother did speak Polish. And she would translate it. And basically, I would give the message back to her. And then finally, I think maybe it was a 45-minute to an hour session, I came up with the suggestion of asking what did that person miss the most. Even I said, I know you don't believe you're not alive, but what do you miss the most? And then she said, I really miss my mother. And I said, what's her name? And the woman told me the name. And I said, let me see if I can have her come down to this level to be with you. And I did something. And next thing we knew, she just closed her eyes and went to sleep. And we tried to wake her. We couldn't. They were about to call the doctor, and then she sat up, and she said, I'm really hungry. Remember that word. I'm really hungry, Mom. And you can just see the anger and all the resentment was just gone. And like most cases, they don't remember those states that they get into. It's like a catatonic state. They're just not aware of what happens. It's like they blink off and blink on.
Gordon, I had no idea you'd been doing this sort of thing.
I really don't do it, Art. That's the reason I've never mentioned this is because I don't do that. I did this in the early days because I was going through so many changes myself that I didn't know what to do. I mean, I was working 18 hours a day, training, meditating, praying, trying to figure out, you know, all this stuff. And so, you know, I didn't have a life at that time. I mean, I had sold all my possessions, my house, everything, just so I could have to eat.
You were looking for your path.
I think I knew what my path was, but I didn't know how it was going to manifest itself. You know, I didn't know. It's like going to a candy store almost, you know, and you don't know what you want to do first. I could do many things, but I didn't know what was going to be the best for me as well as the best for somebody else because I was having a lot of physical problems. Every time I saw a vision, I would have headaches.
You still do, don't you?
Not too much, because I don't do those deep sessions anymore.
All right. Hold on. We're at the bottom of the hour. We'll be right back. From the high desert, the great American Southwest, this is Coast to Coast AM. My guest is Gordon Michael Scallion.
is Art Bell, inviting you to join me every weeknight for interesting and controversial talk from Area 51 in Nevada, UFOs, time travel, the paranormal. Look, if you're talking about it, possibly just even thinking about it, you can guarantee we'll be covering it. It's Coast to Coast with me, Art Bell. Take a flight into strange airspace. Explore a world of mystery and supernatural phenomena. Don't take a wrong turn, though. You might run into the monsters of your dreams. This week on Greenland, Mark Smith, author of Auras. See them in only 60 seconds. Hello, I'm Art Bell. I'll guide you safely through Greenland into the Kingdom of Nine. I'm Art Bell. I just happen to be in the neighborhood, so I drop by to extend a special invitation for you to join me Sunday for Dreamland. It should be a great show. My guest will be Dr. Elvin Taylor. The topic, subliminal perception. Don't miss it. Sunday, Dreamland, right here on everybody's favorite radio station.
You're listening to Coast AM with Art Bell, live on the CBC Radio Network. To call the show toll-free from across the nation, dial 1-800-618-8255. The wildcard direct lines are area code 702-727-1295. That number is 702-727-1295. And if you've never called the show, try the first-time caller line at area code 702-727-1222. Anybody east of the Rocky Mountains can use the first-time caller line at area code 702-727-1222. When your call is answered, please turn down your radio. Each caller will be allowed up to 3 minutes, giving more listeners a chance to join in. And now, enjoy Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
By the boot-hog wall, there's a market stall, but the hint that she leads you to. These days, I feel my life just like a river running through the air of the town.
Reach Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye. From west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. Or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network.
Yes, it is. We're talking with Gordon Michael Scallion, and this half hour we're definitely going to take calls. So those are the numbers if you have any questions about possession, earth changes, all that which Gordon Michael Scallion talks about, then I guess it's time to pick up the phone and join us. I'm Art Bell, and with one short pause for the Sacred Sax, we'll be right back and we'll go to the phones. I want to definitely give Gordon an opportunity to get in a plug. We haven't even done that for, I know you've got a newsletter, Gordon, and you keep everybody very closely in touch with what you see coming, and you've recorded your predictions for a very long time now, and that's something people can get. How do they do that?
They can go online, which is the easiest and fastest way, which is intuitiveflash.com, or they can write us at Intuitiveflash, P.O. Box 367, West Chesterfield, New Hampshire, 03466, or Monday through Thursday, they can call 603-256-6520.
All right. Everything has to be done twice, so do the address and the phone number one more time. Everybody by now has got their pencil.
Okay. Email or the web address is intuitiveflash.com. The address is P.O. Box 367, West Chesterfield, New Hampshire, 03466. And the phone number, Monday through Thursday, 603-256-6520.
All right, good. All right, Gordon, I'd like to take, if we could, a few phone calls.
Sure.
All right, here we go. First-time caller line, you're on the air with Gordon Michael Scallion. Hello.
Yeah, hi. This is Jonathan from Atlanta. How are you?
Okay, Jonathan.
I have a question for your caller. Really, it's a two-part question. I was listening for the last couple of hours as I'm traveling tonight, and what struck me is interesting is I read James Redfield's books just recently about new insights, and some of the similarities with what you've talked about, how people are sort of gaining new consciousness about things that are happening in our world. I'd like you to maybe comment on that. And second, I guess this question is one that comes to mind when I hear discussions about possessions. I think about some of the events prophesied in the Bible. And, the racing forward that seems to be taking place today and how this is sort of foretold. Do you think this may lead us to what is foretold in the book of Revelation?
Both are really good questions. Why don't we take number two first? Do you think that we are on line, on course and glide path for what is told in the Bible?
I think many of the prophecies, especially some of the works of Peter, are indeed coming true. I think prophecy, as it was recorded in the Testaments, I think we're seeing elements of that now. We could look at any time period and see battles of light and dark occurring. We can go back a millennium and see that since 2,000 years ago. But I do think that Revelation, my insights on Revelation is that it is more of a book of all times. It's kind of like how consciousness moves. If you read Revelation from the perspective of it trying to give us lessons of life, then we get a better understanding of it. So the simple answer is, yes, I think many of the biblical prophecies, as well as Native American and many other faiths and belief systems, I think they're all happening right now. I think we're right in the middle of it.
Mm-hmm. And on James Redfield, on this new consciousness?
We definitely are in a new consciousness. More and more people are becoming aware. We see it in particular with their children. We see how much brighter they are, much more aware. My experience is that people are becoming more and more intuitive. It's like, intuition is a natural part of our being that we have just shut down. And now we're unfolding like a flower. So the new consciousness is that we're seeing the bigger picture. We're seeing the potential. And we're also realizing the ramifications of wrong decisions. It's almost like we opened a door and went into another room and we're seeing different colors. And that's how I equate it to right now, that a new consciousness is unfolding at the same time all these other changes are going on.
It's kind of like a race in a way, isn't it?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Wildcard Line, you're on the air with Gordon Michael Scallion. Hi.
Hey, this is Scott from Grand Rapids, Michigan.
Hello, Scott.
Hey, aloha, guys. Fantastic show this evening.
Thank you.
Hey, your thoughts on what we're doing here in this country and then perhaps in south of the, in the other hemisphere, the elements that we're feeding our sun, whether it's being done from the dark side of the moon or just atomic testing that we've done here on the planet that's speeding up our DNA through the sunshine and the other energy rays that's increasing our vibration and our awareness, making us ultra human, and then that kind of puts us towards, as you say, some of the prophecies that were coming earlier.
Well, maybe you're talking about that change in consciousness. I don't know. You kind of twisted it around a few things there, but there are a lot of people who feel that the atomic testing changed something, that the energy from the sun has a great effect. I know you talk about the molten center of the Earth. Is that all tied up?
Yeah. Anything, first of all, the sun and the Earth, in fact, all the planets in our sun system, they all talk to each other. They talk to each other through a series of rays that exchange. So we tend to think that we're drawing sunlight from the sun, but we're also drawing six other vibrations. So, you know, magnetism, electricity, heat, you know, all these forces that we know about and some that we don't know about are coming to the Earth. But in order for the Earth to draw these forces, it must also give back, which means that when we do nuclear testing, when we have a consciousness of a society that's negative, when we do things that violates nature, all of these things feed back to the sun, and we see the reactions. We see it building. Now, in addition to this, we also must look at the fact that the sun goes through a cycle too. Not only does it go through a magnetic pole cycle that it recently occurred, but it also goes through cycles of activity, not just sunspots now, you know, the 11-year cycle, but it goes through bigger cycles, and we're in one of those right now too. So it's like everything you could imagine is now being played out.
I can imagine a lot. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Gordon Michael Scallion. Hello.
Hello. My name is Lawrence. I'm in Austin, Texas.
Hey, Lawrence.
I find it's interesting that you mentioned that the planets have their own kind of influence and personality. The Sanskrit word for planet and by extension, the personality of that planet is graha, and then the personality of somebody here on Earth, just the little people or whatever, is griha. So they're definitely related. I just wanted to kind of tell you that I had my own personal kind of possession experience, not myself, but with a friend of mine. And as rare as it is, he actually knew after a while that he did have something going on. At one point in time, he had informed me that he had woken up in the middle of the night and felt like there was some kind of presence or something in the room with him. And after a while, he came to realize that it wasn't outside of him, but, you know, in him. Anyway, my question to you is, I saw a movie recently that that kind of did a drama thing, you know, spoof or what, I don't think it was a spoof exactly. It was like some kind of a thing where they were taking the possession away from a boy. And the priest had gone to a library and looked up information on, you know, how to do a possession, a dispossession or whatever. And
exorcism.
There you go. Thank you. And anyway, one of the things that they came up with is the time of changing. And it's like I could never do anything for my friend. I mean, I can pray and I can, and I know those things matter. But I wondered if there was maybe, you know, with regard to like that time of changing, if there was maybe a better time or any kind of a better technique to utilize, just for a layman to know.
That's a good question.
Yeah, it's a great question. Many influences where you feel like there's a presence in the room. Oftentimes, that is not a possession. It's either someone who currently is alive, it's just their astral body visiting. Sometimes it can be other than that. But when people are going through these changes internally, it's not, we all look for the quick fix. You know, we have a virus on our computers, we want to get a patch and fix it.
Yep.
But consciousness and the personality is not always that quickly. You know, it took years and maybe lifetimes, if we believe in reincarnation, to get to a certain point. The greatest healing that I have seen is that when one person truly cares about another and truly stays the course with them, doesn't give up, the power that I have seen of a single individual working with other people is just unbelievable. I see it with a lot of healers, people who are working with Reiki and other healing modalities. You can just see their true care of service, of being in service, and it makes all the difference in the world.
Trouble is, in today's world, we're not patient. Corporations aren't patient. People aren't patient with relationships. They walk away. It's easier to walk away. Too many take the easy path, and instead of staying with somebody and fighting, they're gone. They just, you know, they're on to the next thing or person or whatever.
Well, it's just like the corporate greed. You know, it's like everything at the for the bottom profit line, you know, and not looking at the bigger picture. And the bigger picture are the people. Now, we're paying the price for the society that's in right now. And, you know, next year, you know, I predicted that we were going to have an upswing in the marketplace, for example, and the end of November, December, and we're seeing that right now. Then it turns next year, and, you know, I see levels between 46 and 4,700 on the Dow within a year. And all of that has to do with the system just being reworked. And so when we take the shortcuts, to, you know, we get by for the next quarter or the next year,
yes,
or the next month in a relationship, we
yes
pay the price. We
yes
have to think long haul, and we have to be in it for the long haul.
Well, that'll be new. Hadn't been that way in a while now. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Gordon Michael Scallion. Hello.
Hi, Art. Hi, Gordon. I've got a question, Gordon. Now,
hi, what was your name?
Greg.
Greg, okay, Greg.
Yeah, Gordon. Now, the banks, I agree with you, first off, that there is going to be a 1929-type depression and crash coming that's headed our way. So, when this happens, the banks, they are so tied into the economy, the fabric of it, that when the economy comes down, the banks are going to follow right with it, and FDIC is not going to be able to cover those kinds of losses. They'll be paying pennies on the dollar, if even that. So let's say you have a person that has a few hundred thousand dollars in cash. How does a person protect that from what you've seen? The stock market's a joke, and you can't bring that kind of money home and stuff it in your mattress.
Makes a good point.
Yeah. There are several things, and these are things that I do and that have worked for me. First of all, I, in spite of what happens to the economy, that your home and key pieces of residential real estate are going to do very well, regardless of the marketplace. And we might argue that who's going to be there to buy them if there's no money? Well, there will be money. It's just that, you know, what will happen is that the government has, the Treasury Department has this great invention called a printing press, and they can just print more money. Just, you know, our debt is out of sight right now, but we'll just, you know, we'll just continue to do it. Now, in truth, what it does is it devalues the dollar. It just goes down, down, and down. So effectively, you have less money value-wise or purchasing power-wise. We may get into a stagnation and a devaluation, actually, of products and services. We may actually see that instead of going up, I think we'll have another recession next year, and I think we're going to see products and services actually dropping in value. So, you know, real estate is a good place to put it. A year and a half ago, I was suggesting that there would still be stocks that would be good and continue to be good. Those are like gold mine stocks, which did very, very well. Certain rare coins, low mintage, certified. These, you know, so the key here is to diversify. Also, having some money in cash that you can take out.
And land, because God's not making any more of it.
Well, you know, there's a housing shortage that's unbelievable in this nation, especially housing that's lower. I mean, in our area here, which is a small community, you can't even find a house under $150,000. They're like rarity, and the average time of a house being on the market in that range is less than 4 days. You know, so, and it's nationally, there's a problem. The high-end houses are tumbling, foreclosures. So, you know, the right kind of real estate, even apartments are going to still do well. It's not going to go to zero. You know, if you look at the Depression, we see that, you know, we had a high unemployment, we had food lines, but the economy just didn't go away. the thing that caused the depression then is the same thing that's going to cause a depression now. And that was fear. Because when our economy is based on consumer spending. When we're fearful and we don't spend, we put our economy at risk. And so, you know, we had 0% finance for automobiles that generated a lot of auto sales. That's now pretty much over. I mean, they're still offering it, but the big numbers aren't there anymore. You know, people who were going to buy bought. So we're seeing the whole economy is going to shift downwards. People who were in the market, you know, lost billions and billions of dollars, they will lose even more in the future. But if you diversify, don't put it in one place. I have money in CDs, short-term, you know, CDs, and I still wouldn't take it out because I don't think it's going to be devalued to zero. But I'm in several different places, and things that I can control is real estate, my own home and my anything else I own that's rental. That's always been my way of my life.
In other words, get control of what's in your sphere of influence.
Yes.
It's that simple, really. I mean, that's all you can do as an individual.
Yes.
You know, Gordon, we've been doing this for a decade, on and off for a decade, and as you probably are aware, I'm retiring at the end of the year. And so I really want to take the opportunity to thank you for all these years.
Well, I wanted to come on. I know when you weren't able to make it last week, there was we received a significant number of emails asking why, you know, I wasn't on the show.
Right.
And the reason is that I wanted to, at least for this go-round, I wanted to say goodbye to you personally, and I wanted to, and that was my way of saying that the time period here has helped, I think, enlighten some people. At least it's got people to think, and if we accomplish that, then I think we've done our job. I can also tell you that the end of the year will not be the end for you in radio.
No doubt.
So I'm sure you don't want to hear that, but
no
I told you this last time when you went off. I said you will be back, and you will be back again, but not the same. It'll be something different, but you will be back.
It's been absolutely spectacular. I mean, over the years with you, it has been an amazing. I've watched you go through metamorphosis in those years.
For sure.
And so I guess the ride isn't over. The ride's never really quite altogether over, is it?
No, it's not the destination. It's the journey.
It's the journey, yeah. Gordon Michael Scallion, thank you, my friend.
You bet. Very best to you.
Good night.
Good night.
Inside that we need so much. The sight of a touch or the scent of a sound or the strength of an oak roots deep in the ground. The wonder of flowers to be covered and then to burst up through tarmac to the sun again. Or to fly to the sun without burning a wing. To lie in a meadow and hear the grass sing. To have all these things in our memory of all. And the universe to come.
For this night, from the high deserts, I'm Art Bell. Good night.